50 feet per day, 8 times faster than it was 30 years ago.
Go back to 1980. Here on this bedrock, we had ice above us 1,500 feet. Look at the trim line over there. That's where the ice surface was in 1980. And all of that volume is lost because this calving is so fast and snowfall upstream isn't resupplying it. So in that sense, yeah, it's going too fast and the glacier is kind of collapsing.
Pfeffer suspects that the Columbia is long past its tipping point and it's only a matter of time before it withers away entirely.
This kind of ice is called dead ice. It's no longer part of the living, active glacier. It's stranded up on the side of the ice stream, and it's melting away and collapsing. And as it does that, all the erosional debris that's on the top continues to concentrate until you have this ice covered in blackness. I'm really interested in the mortality of the glacier right here. There's something very rich and very intense about the changing landscape. You know, I feel the end, I feel the death right here.
The problem is, it's not just the Columbia that's on its way out. Glaciers everywhere, across the Rockies, Andes, Alps, and Himalayas, are in their death throes.
The people that live near the mountains and watch the glaciers know that the world is changing. We are heading towards Glacier National Park without any glaciers. We're seeing, you know, huge changes in Glacier Bay in Alaska and other places. If you go, if you look, you see it.
The consensus is that in the next 50 to 100 years, mountain glaciers almost everywhere will simply disappear. From the loss of mountain glaciers alone, sea levels will rise by almost a foot, displacing millions of people around the world. But the biggest cost will be the loss of these huge natural reservoirs of fresh water. Water that 1/6 of the world's population depends on. The hardest hit will be in Asia, where nearly a billion people get their drinking water from Himalayan glaciers. The abrupt collapse of the world's mountain glaciers raises even more disturbing questions about the Earth's biggest tracts of ice, the polar ice sheets of Antarctica and Greenland.
The real wild cards are what the big ice sheets are going to do. We're already seeing the Greenland ice sheet start to behave in rather disturbing ways.
We're playing with fire, if you will, when it comes to the ice sheets. We don't know whether if we get these big, massive freight train-like beasts going, whether we can stop them.
The potential for the polar ice sheets to flood the planet is staggering. If all of Greenland and Antarctica were to melt, the oceans would rise 200 feet. But over geologic time, these ancient bulwarks of ice have withstood many bouts with climate warming. Until a few years ago, scientists thought the ice sheets were simply too big and too dense to be an immediate risk. But the latest evidence is making them rethink. The first wake-up call came from the West Antarctic Peninsula. In the summer of 2002, a NASA satellite photographed a Rhode Island-sized slab of ice called Larsen B as it sheared off the ice shelf. Other collapses followed, turning the assumption that it would take thousands of years for the big ice sheets to melt on its head.
The ice sheets surprised us. We sort of thought that the little glaciers would melt when it got warmer and that the big ice sheets wouldn't do much.